Well, welcome everybody here to week one of this six-week seminar with Dr. Lloyd Turner. And it's good to have you with us, Lloyd. We're really looking forward to you leading us through these 6 weeks here on Adopt a Cop and Adopt Your Street, and seeing how the Lord can use these tools to help us shift the spiritual climate wherever we are at. And just wanted to welcome everybody that has joined us already here on the live session. I know there's others that will be joining us by the recording later on as well. But we have Brent Bielenberg and Tanya Mullenhauer and Nancy Liatsis with us already on the live session. So welcome, everybody. I know we also have Becky Haas and myself, Benji McNaughton. I'll be hosting us each week here. So looking forward to a great time here as we go through this online seminar. And I would like to just lead us with a word of prayer, and then we will turn it over to Dr. Lloyd. Father, thank you so much for bringing us together from many different parts of the country and around the world, Lord, to learn more and to study and to receive from you through your servant, Dr. Lloyd Turner. And we just want to dedicate this entire seminar to you, and we ask that you will speak to us, lead us, and guide us now as Dr. Lloyd leads us. We pray that you will give us the tools and give us all that you have for us to receive and for us to be able to implement to see your kingdom come right where we live and work and minister, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, with that as a backdrop, let me turn it over to Dr. Lloyd Turner, and take us away, Lloyd. Lead us through this time here.
Well, welcome to everybody for joining us on this first session of a class in Applied Prayer Evangelism. We're calling it Adopt a Street and Adopt a Cop. And as you know, the Adopt a Street procedure has been around for several years. It's been available through transformourworld.org, and it's in now more than 600 registered cities on the Transform Our World website, and at least 400 more that we're aware of in Indonesia and other places. So we'll talk about that for the first three sessions, and then we'll do three sessions on Adopt a Cop, which, as you know, started relatively recently in response to the concerns about policemen and police brutality and police protection and citizen awareness. So they actually complement each other very well. One of them deals with the policemen that are protecting law and order, and the other one has to do with protecting the citizens that are living in your neighborhood. So as you adopt your streets, we would like you also to adopt your cops, so that we have both the law enforcement community and the people being prayed for. Just in terms of the organization of this course, our class tonight or today will be on an overview of applied prayer evangelism, emphasizing street adoption and changing the spiritual climate. Our next session will be not next week, but 2 weeks from today, where we talk about adopting cities and states. And we know that Bless Minnesota is on this call. We will thank you for joining us. And we want to hear about good things happening in Minnesota and other states where these methodologies are being applied. The following week, March 22nd, we'll talk about the global street adoption movement and how Adopt a Street has gone to 59 nations at this point, including Indonesia, Hong Kong, Great Britain, places in many countries in Africa and South America. And we actually have participants from South America that will be joining us on this call. So welcome from wherever you're coming from. Then on the 29th of March, we'll talk about the Adopt a Cop, and we'll describe how the Adopt a Cop movement got started. We'll give you some statistics on policemen that were shot in 2014. We'll also talk about fatal shootings in 2015 from an article from the Washington Post. And that's a background for April 5th. And on April 5th, we'll have Becky Haas from Johnson City, Tennessee, talking about her very successful and innovative Adopt-a-Cop approach. Becky, are you available to say hi to us?
Yes, I'm here, Lloyd, and very excited about this class.
Okay, so Becky, you've done a tremendous job of lining up different agencies and as well as the law enforcement people in the community, and we want you to be able to share with us on April 5th some of your lessons learned.
All right, I'm excited. Looking forward to it.
Okay, and then on April 12th, we'll talk about other cities that have started Adopt-A-Cop or are considering it. I'm hoping to get Pastor Anthony Summers from Vallejo, California, to join us, and we may have real-time testimonies from East Palo. I started my career as an urban planning professor at the University of Iowa. I taught there for 3 years, and I taught at the social work school at Bryn Mawr College for 3 years. And then I got into project management in the telecommunications and pharmaceuticals industries, and I've done that for the last several years. Having recently retired, I'm spending more time on writing books. So just to let you know some of my titles, the first title that I wrote is called Highways of Holiness, and it's about preparing the way for the Lord. It's a spiritual history of New Jersey that we're using quite successfully in this area. Then the next book that Joanne and I wrote together, that's my wife, it was the Street Adopters Handbook. And this was written in 2011 for the Harvest Evangelism National Conference here in Newark, New Jersey. And it talks about how we started Adopt a Street in Newark and how it went to 250 cities within the next 2 years. Then our friends from Hong Kong were interested in sharing this, so they wrote the Chinese equivalent of it. You can see the title there. It's Adopt a Street, and it's used in 10 Adopt a Street projects in Hong Kong. And hopefully we'll have Regina with us on the call, either live or offline. She was one of the people, I think she was the primary translator of the book here. So we want to thank her and welcome her and all of her colleagues that are successfully using Adopt a Street in Hong Kong. I'll also talk next time about some of the ideas in my book, Proclaiming the Kingdom. And I talk specifically about bitterness and covetousness and contentment that are significant factors in city development. And I'll show you how that related to Newark as well as Resistencia, where Ed Silvoso had done his original pioneering work. And then lastly, this is a book I'm currently doing. It's a book called Newark, City of Destiny. And I was asked to write this book for this year for Newark's 350th anniversary and to let people know that Newark is a city that was dedicated to God 350 years ago and that God has used people throughout its history to advance his purposes. So that's an introduction of myself. So at that point, this point, I'll go on to my screen share. Benji, you're still with us, I believe.
Yes, I'm here, Lloyd.
Okay, so I'm going to share my PowerPoint and let me know when you can see that.
You bet. Everything's looking good to me. And let me just double check. Becky, can you see the screen okay there?
Yes, looks great.
Okay. If for some reason anybody on the line, if you can't see it, please send us a note right away in the chat room. But everything should be rolling away here, Lloyd. So go ahead.
Okay, so this is basically the outline that I used last summer when Joanne and I were teaching in Hong Kong. We went through all these topics in one day. So I broke it into three sections. And tonight we're going to do introductions, talk about Jesus as a city reacher, and give you a background on street adoption. And then in later sessions, we'll talk about how to launch and grow street adoption initiatives, how to pray for your adopted streets, street adoption testimonies, the global canopy of prayer evangelism, and then we'll have questions and answers in each session and an impartation time. So on the screen here, in the upper right-hand corner, it's a little small, but you can see how Adopt a Street was launched to 120,000 Christians in Jakarta in 2012 at the World Prayer Conference. So they have now done about 400 cities where they're using Adopt a Street around the world. And we'll talk about that in session three. Okay, so repeating again for weeks 4, 5, and 6, we'll talk about Adopt a Cop. Week 4 is about Adopt a Cop as America's felt need. Week 5 is a specific Adopt a Cop implementation that Becky's done in Johnson City. And week 6, we'll talk about San Jose, Vallejo, and other cities. Okay, so why do we talk about city reaching and applied prayer evangelism as being synonymous? Well, if you look at the ministry of Jesus as recorded in the book of Luke, Jesus spent a lot of his time doing what we call city reaching. In year one, he announced his ministry to bring the kingdom of God to cities. In year two, he commissioned 12 disciples to preach, heal, and proclaim the kingdom. In year three, he sent out 72 others to reach cities he was about to visit. And in the last few weeks of his earthly ministry, he actually visited the cities that received his disciples. So we'll talk about each one of those points. In year one, Jesus announced that in Luke 4:43 that his purpose is to bring the kingdom of God to cities. He says, "I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to other towns as well, for I was sent for this purpose." So there's a specific mention of adopting, of reaching cities there in that section in Luke chapter 4. Then in year 2, as you know, Jesus sent out the 12 disciples to preach, heal, and proclaim the kingdom. And in Luke 9, we read, "And he called the 12 together and gave them power and authority over all the demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal." Then in year 3, he expanded the circle to 72 other unnamed disciples. And this is the beginning of the chapter that you'll recognize when we talk about Ed Silvoso's book, Prayer Evangelism. Luke 10, verse 1 says, "After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town and place where he himself was about to go." And just as an anecdote on that, when we first became acquainted with adopting streets, it was in Resistencia, Argentina. We put out an invitation for people to adopt streets in Resistencia, and we got 72 signed forms. So we praise the Lord that he was giving us a faith lesson from Luke 10, even as we learned about it in Resistencia. Then in the last weeks of Jesus' ministry, he visited the towns and cities that his disciples had prepared. And it says in this rather small verse in Luke 13:22, "And he went on his way through towns and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem." So the question, folks, is this: if Jesus spent so much of his time on earth reaching cities, should not we share his same passion for cities? In August of 2007, Joanne and I met with leaders from Newark, and we sat around the table. We had these Adopt-a-Street forms that you can see on the table, and our ministry partners said that they wanted to work with us to adopt all the streets of Newark. And in the next 2 years, Newark became the first city in America that had 100% of its streets adopted for daily prayer. Well, how does it work? Well, as you might guess, the driver is prayer evangelism. In Luke 10, we speak peace to every house. Then we fellowship to find the felt need. Then we minister to heal the sick. And then when that has happened, and only then, do we proclaim that the kingdom of God is at hand. And this should be very familiar to us if you've been to any of the Harvest conferences. So what's the mechanism? Well, on www.transformourworld.org, you can go in, you can adopt your street. You can set up a street adoption initiative, and you can actually adopt as many streets as you'd like from any city around the world. And then there are other blogs and other resources that you can check out there on how to use that Transform Our World website. So what does it mean to adopt a street? Well, to adopt means to take another person's child and bring it up as one's own. And when we went into a longer teaching on this in Hong Kong, we pointed out that the adoption routines came from ancient Rome, and that the people who were adopted in Rome were very high-class individuals. Probably the best known of them would have been Julius Caesar, who was adopted by Caesar Augustus. So this is a very special privileged situation, and Paul's listeners in his day would have understood that adoption was a very favored status. By adopting streets, we're inserting a spirit of adoption into our communities. We're actually expecting that to change the spiritual climate. And by adopting, we do a systematic day-by-day prayer that is not just a one-time prayer walk, but it's actually a lifestyle of blessing. And the results on it, well, if you read in Luke 10, It says, Satan falls down, the people's eyes are opened, and the gospel of the kingdom is embraced by all. And that's what we're trying to achieve in our city of Newark this year, is we're trying to get people to realize that Newark is still a city on a hill. It's still a city that is adopted for prayer, and it's a city that has a kingdom of God destiny that all should embrace. So we're hoping to implement that in very practical ways here in our own city, even as people are doing in cities all over the world. So there's a domino effect, and if you've seen the domino chain video, you'll recognize this. The first step of the domino is that every sheep has a shepherd. That's what we get when we adopt every street, because if every person lives along a street, when we get every street adopted, then every person is prayed for in some sense. The second level of prayer evangelism and a second level of street adoption would be that every sheep would know its shepherd. So that's a lot more involving to get everyone to know who's praying for them, but that's certainly the goal that we want to shoot toward. We want everyone who lives, works, and worships in our city to be adopted and to know who's praying for them. And as we do that, we expect, thirdly, that the spiritual climate will be changed as prayers are answered. I had some pretty remarkable answers to prayer at a recent meeting I was in. I prayed for a man who was born with cerebral palsy, and he had also a spinal stenosis case. And I just met him at a meeting, and he said, would you pray for me? So my wife and I prayed for him, and he was expectant that God was going to do something that night. And he said he'd been to dozens of doctors and chiropractors, but he wanted a touch from God. So we prayed for him, and 5 minutes later, as we got done praying, he said, my pain is completely gone. His prayers were answered, and I hope and pray for that individual tonight, that he continues to be free of pain and to let people know that Jesus answered his prayers. And then fourthly, we want to see the kingdom of God coming in and people coming into the kingdom. So that's the prayer chain, and one level of prayer evangelism goes to the other, and before you know it, the whole city is changed through prayer evangelism. Mentoring resources for prayer evangelism include Ed Silvoso's book by that title, Prayer Evangelism, the book that he wrote with Dave Thompson, the monograph My City, God's City, the Street Adopters Handbook, which I've just mentioned, as well as Transformation DVDs, of which there are more than 40 now, and the School of Transformation. So that brings us to questions and answers. This slide shows a picture of 10 churches that were being engaged in street adoption in April of 2012. Each one of them adopted a different section of Hong Kong, and they've seen some pretty remarkable results as they've done that. So I'm just going to stop sharing at this point. I'm going to go back to the main session, and we'll pause and ask questions that people may want to submit. I'm writing in the chat here, so I can see your chat as well.
This is great, Lloyd. Maybe you and I can just chat a little bit here while people are formulating their questions or comments about this. You said that you started really in 2007 with your ministry partners. Maybe backing up a little bit before that, these were folk, I mean, maybe describe the folks that you first gathered around the table with and strategized with. How did you know them? What was kind of your level of relationship and all that? Maybe you could speak to that a little bit.
Okay, and then there's a question from Nancy. How many people met with you at that initial meeting from Newark? So I'll try to address both of those. So Pray for Newark actually started with three people coming into agreement. It was a pastor from World Impact named David Ingersoll. And we actually drove into Newark. We met with staff at World Impact. And the Lord had given me an assignment to take my Highways of Holiness book to the leaders of Newark. And Joanne and I said, wow, we don't know very many people in Newark. But he reminded us that we knew our mission partners at World Impact, and we knew another mission partner. So we just went in and said, we have this book on praying for highways. And they thought about it after the first meeting at World Impact. There were about 10 or 15 people at the meeting. And I got a call back from Pastor David Ingersoll, and he said, I've been praying about it, and I want to partner with you to get all of the streets of Newark adopted for daily prayer.
Excellent. Excellent.
So the meeting that I displayed on the screen a minute ago, that was about 6 months later. We had 21 residential neighborhoods in Newark, and we had a captain assigned to each one. And the captain's job was to make sure that the streets in their neighborhood got adopted for prayer. So that was after we'd gotten quite a bit more organized. At the very beginning, we had no idea how we were going to get the city adopted. It was just something the Lord said he wanted us to do.
Yeah. No, that's awesome. So you had that initial meeting with the three of you, you said, and then about 6 months later, there was kind of that larger meeting and some other folks had come on board and you're getting strategic and all right. That. You said there was, there's 21
neighborhoods.
21 neighborhoods. Okay. And so at that meeting, you appointed or people volunteered for the neighborhood. How did that kind of the technical aspect of it, I guess, how did that work?
Okay, I'm going to give you a website called www.city-data.com.
Perfect.
And this is a website that I believe has been put together by real estate agents, and it has most of the cities in the U.S., and I think maybe Canada as well. And if you go into that and list, say, Durham, North Carolina, or Bloomington, Minnesota, whatever your city is, you'll see a lot of statistics about your city. And then it will actually give you the residential neighborhoods that have been defined by the realtors, and it'll list every street in each neighborhood.
Excellent.
So that's a great way for you to get to know the streets in your neighborhood and start praying for it.
Yeah. Wonderful.
We didn't find this out right away, by the way. We stumbled on all these things that I'm teaching you here. So we're kind of giving you the short answer.
No, that's great. That's great. I love it. I love the kind of the story behind the story, you know, people that may be kind of brand new to this or even somewhat familiar with it think, oh man, you know, they really did it up right from the get-go in Newark. They got everything going, 100% street adoption, but everything starts with a small beginning, right, Lloyd?
Yeah. Let me give you the next step here. So Pastor Ingersoll got his list of donors, the people that contribute to his mission organization, and there were about 100 people on that list. So he went out to them, and we got their first 100 streets adopted through World Impact. So we just started building around the World Impact building, and then we ran out of streets. Basically, we knew a few, and he knew a few, but we had 800 streets left to go. So at that point, we really felt that the Lord was having us reach out to other ministries. So we got involved with the African-American community, Dr. Bernard Wilkes. And we got involved with the Brazilian community, with a church over in the North Ward in Newark. And we got involved with people from the islands. And we just went around the globe, going from one ethnic group to another in Newark, telling them about the story. And we got them to adopt some of their own neighborhoods.
Excellent. Excellent. Was there pretty good, was there pretty quick response and buy-in from people? Were people a little bit more reserved? What was kind of the response of the people there that you were engaging?
You know, when we first present the idea to people, ideally it's at a midweek meeting, like a Wednesday night or Tuesday night meeting that's fairly relaxed. And the Holy Spirit just shows up at those meetings because this is something that Jesus wants more than we do. He loves the cities and he loves the people. And if you ask people to adopt a street at that meeting, you'll get a very high response rate. Mm. Now, we made the mistake of printing out a brochure and telling people, well, take this brochure home and pray about it. And if you do that, you significantly lower your response rate.
Yeah.
Because the devil starts telling people lies about you don't have enough time, you've got too much on your plate. And he starts negating the work that the Holy Spirit does at that first meeting.
Yeah.
So I can't overemphasize how much that initial meeting needs to have the presence of the Holy Spirit. And he will speak to people and say, well, you live on Second Street. You can at least adopt Second Street.
Yeah. Yeah. That's awesome. That's awesome. Just a reminder, if you got a question or a comment here about what Lloyd was sharing here tonight, please go ahead and put it there in the chat box. We'd love to interact with that a little bit. Another question that I had, Lloyd, was you mentioned about taking these principles and presenting them in Resistencia. What was the time frame of that? When did you do that?
Okay, so very interesting question. I wrote my book in fall of 2006. We went to the Harvest Evangelism Conference in Argentina, and I met Pastor Alejandro Huschek, who was a member of the Resistencia City Reaching movement that Ed and Dave pioneered, along with Chuck Starnes was there, I think, even at the beginning.
Yeah.
And he asked me to come and do a two-day workshop on Highways of Holiness. Hmm. So the book was just in print less than a month then. And he translated two chapters of it into Spanish. And he gave a live translation as I talked about the biblical concept of a highway of holiness from Luke 35:8, Isaiah 35:8, from Isaiah 62, verses 10 through 12, and other passages. And the blessings that the Jewish people expected when they prayed for the highways. Also, Psalm 84, verse 5 said, "Blessed is the man who prays, whose heart is set on pilgrimage, whose heart is set on the road to Zion," if you will. Mm-hmm. So we had a two-day conference, and at the end of the 2 days, he had a form put together, and it said, "I agree to adopt the following street in Resistencia, street or highway." And what he said was so interesting, Benji, because he said, he interrupted me after I said adopt a highway, and he said, you know, in Spanish, the word highway has two meanings. It's either a thoroughfare, which is an autopista, or it's a calle, which is a street. Mm. So he broadened what I was teaching to say to his congregation, well, you can adopt either a highway or a street.
Very cool.
And that's when we got the signed forms. We asked people to sign the forms at the end of the conference. They brought them up to the altar. They put them down on the altar. And the pastor gave a closing prayer. We dismissed and went to lunch. And then the pastor's daughter counted up the forms, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72 signed forms.
Wow.
And Benji, I can't tell you what a holy moment that was. Mm-hmm. Because we knew that the Lord was verifying exactly what we see in Luke 10, verse 1, with the 72 unnamed disciples.
Yeah, that's really cool. That's really, really cool. I love it. Love it.
So we realized at that point that this was not just about Resistencia Argentina.
For sure.
And some historical thing that God had done through prayer evangelism and harvest evangelism. But it was also for our home city of Newark. And it was also to be a model that would be replicated around the world.
Yeah, that's awesome. And another question I had, again, I just want to open it up to anybody else as well. If you have a question, go ahead and stick it there in the chat box for Lloyd. And but another question I had, and maybe you're going to address this if you are in a future session, I don't want to steal your thunder, but I know there were some significant social indicators that you did begin to see there in Newark as you adopted a certain percentage of streets. You saw crime reduce and all of that kind of thing. Question one would be, you know, kind of how long into the process did it take for you to start to see some tangible results in that way? Okay. And secondly, how did you learn those statistics? Where did they come from?
Yeah, so what we did is we took the data from a Newark City map. We didn't know about city-data.com at the point. So we just went to an index of streets, and we prepared a spreadsheet that had 903 rows in it for the streets in Newark. And then we grouped them by ward so we could tell what percent of streets were adopted for each at each ward, as well as the overall city level. And at the end of 2008, we had 33% of the streets adopted, a little over 300. Mm-hmm. And in January 2nd, I think it was, of 2009, we picked up the headlines for the Newark paper, and it told us that the crime rate dropped 33% last year. Mm-hmm. And so that was just such a tremendous answer to prayer, because 33% of the streets adopted, 33% reduction in homicides in Newark that year.
Yeah.
And, you know, the people that are doing this in Vallejo have seen very similar things. They got 30% of their streets adopted, and their crime dropped 30%. Mm-hmm. In Jacksonville, Florida, We introduced this in 2009 at the ITN conference, and the folks from Jacksonville started their own Adopt a Street initiative, and they have a lot of streets. Jacksonville has 10,000 streets, more than any other city in North America, or at least in the U.S. Wow. And they got 1,200 streets adopted. So they got 12% adopted, and their crime, their murder rate dropped 12%.
Wow. Great.
So does this always happen? No, it doesn't always happen. But it's just a sign of favor from the Lord when it does.
Yeah.
And then we went along further, and we saw 100% of the streets adopted in fall of 2009. We launched that at, we announced that at the conference in Honolulu at the Transform Our World Conference. Mm-hmm. And the just a few months later, Newark had its first calendar month that was free of murders. Mm-hmm. In 44 years. So 100% of the streets adopted, 100% decline in murders for one calendar month.
Wow. Wow. Tremendous.
Now, I wish I could say there was a direct proportion so that if you got 100% of your streets adopted, you'd have zero crime always.
Yeah.
Well, that hasn't happened yet. Yeah. And I think it's just a sign of favor from the Lord that he's showing you that you're on the right track. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't over or under interpret it, but it's certainly no substitute for law enforcement. We still need law enforcement in a world where people are sinful. We still need hospitals. We still need governments to do a lot of things. But this is just a way that God manifests himself, because he cares more about the people on the streets than we do.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And just to echo that as well, I think it's a clear indicator of the, you know, the spiritual realm being shifted there into the hands of God's people, where we see, like in Luke 10, such a clear example there, where they come back reporting all these phenomenal things, and Jesus says, well, here's why you've seen all this happen. I saw Satan falling like lightning from heaven, as you mentioned. And so it's a great indicator that the spiritual climate, you know, where there's this constant battle going on, there's been a shift, you know, and the devil has fallen. And we know from experience as well, though, he falls and he likes to get back up, and we have to get him to continue to fall and fall and fall continuously, you know, throughout our neighborhood, throughout the city, throughout the region and the country, over and over and over again, you know, for those kinds of things to sustain and to see that happen. So,
yeah, we got a lot of really interesting stories, particularly the first year or two that we did Adopt a Street. There was a woman from Ghana who was one of our captains. Hmm. She prayed over a section in the North Ward. And one night she woke up in the middle of the night, and someone was out in the street screaming, saying, "This is my street." And it was a demonic situation going on there. The guy was screaming that basically he was feeling the spiritual climate of that street change, and he didn't like it. So he was crying out in the middle of the night. So she rebuked him. The guy stopped shouting and screaming, and she realized at that point that was, again, another tangible evidence that her prayers were having an impact on the neighborhood that she was praying for.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's tremendous. That's tremendous. Right on. Well, if anyone else would like to join the conversation here, you can send a little note there in the chat box. You may have to scroll around a little bit on the bottom, but it should be right there. If you have a question or a comment you would like Lloyd to address, please go ahead and stick that there in the chat box. Another question. Oh, there we go. Looks like we got a question from Nancy. Were the police aware of the Adopt a Street initiative in Newark?
And the answer is yes. We have a lieutenant named Sergeant Leslie Jones, who is writing a book called The Pistol Carrying Cop. He's been a policeman in Newark for 35 years or so. And he was part of our initial group, and we had him speak at several rallies. We also have a city clergy council in Newark, which is funded by the city, which is unusual in American cities. Hmm. Benji, you know, we took the first video that Harvest did and told the clergy council about it. And they said, well, can you come and share this? So I said, sure, we'll be glad to share it. So we come into the meeting. There's about 30 clergy. They were Protestant, Catholic. There were maybe a rabbi. There was an imam there, and all kinds of people that pray for people when there are bad situations like burglaries, murders, etc. So they opened the meeting and they said, "Would Imam so and so open us in prayer?" And I started saying to Joanne, "What are we doing here at this meeting?" So after they had the opening prayer, they turned to us and they said, "Oh, please tell us about the Newark video." So we showed the Newark video, and it was about 12 minutes, as you know. And at the end of the video, the first comment was from the imam. And he said, "This is exactly what we need in Newark."
Yeah, look at that. Praise God.
You can only ask God to explain it. So yeah, the police were aware of it. In fact, one of the lessons learned on this is to try to get high-level buy-in from your police department. You know, our God is a jealous God. And he does his best work in impossible situations. But sometimes people like to take credit for the work of God. Amen? And what happened was we saw three situations where the homicide rate declined dramatically. And each time there was a press release where the government took credit for the work. And each time the crime had gone down, and then after the press release, the crime went up. And so that was a very sobering thing for us, that the mayor was a Christian mayor, but there is such a tendency for politicians to take credit for reducing crime that they felt they had to take the credit for it. And there was very little recognition of the prayer movement in those releases.
Yeah, that's a good point, a good lesson for all of us to be aware of. To carry forward and all that, we need to keep doing what we're doing, and in that way, really serve the leaders of the city, whether they recognize it or not. Right? I mean, it's like you said, they love to take advantage of those things and use it for their own purposes. And, you know, we need to put that in the hands of the Lord and keep pressing forward and doing what we're called to do and kind of let the chips fall where they may is, I think, probably a good way to go about it. So
that's right. Well, since we have Becky Haas on the call, maybe we could ask Becky to tell us how she used the Pray for Newark video in her city.
Well, I saw that video some time ago, a couple of years ago, and I spoke in our church one time and showed it as a part of my message. And then in my work at the police department, that in our lesson on Adopt a Cop. But one of our first meetings, I showed the group of pastors the Adopt a Street video from Newark, and they were very excited. Several of them ended up showing it in their church, and one gentleman has a ministerial association. They showed it there, and it was a great visioning tool to show our city, how a very simple method how we can reach out and make a difference.
Great. Well, thank you, Becky, for sharing that. I know you said you shared that all over Tennessee, so we're really pleased that you got something of value out of it. And I know that the folks in Minnesota are on mute, but they have done a tremendous job of taking Adopt a Street to the state level, as well as I believe it's more than 100 cities now in Minnesota that are doing Adopt a Street through the Bless Minnesota initiative.
Yeah, it's tremendous, tremendous.
We have time for a couple other questions here. If you're online with us and have any burning questions, we can say a lot more about Adopt a Street. There's a lot more details that we haven't given you, but I wanted you to get the sense of the excitement and how we had no grand plan when we started this. We're not trying to launch a worldwide movement. We were just being faithful when the Lord told us that he was going to do a new work of grace in the city of Newark, and he was inviting us to come along. Mm-hmm. And the Adopt a Street just came out of that, and it just led from one thing to another. And with through the harvest videos, it got to 30-some nations in the first year, and now it's up around 60 or more nations. We actually have our first street adoption in Antarctica this year. So
wow, there's actual streets there then.
yeah, there's a a person from Cape Town, South Africa, that adopted streets right on at the South Pole. So the penguins in South America are being prayed for.
That is awesome. That is awesome, Lloyd. One question, if anybody else has, still formulating a question or typing it in, continue to do that. Lloyd, all the resources that you held up and showed, how do we get a hold of those, or how can people get them?
Okay, so the books that I've written are available on Amazon.com. Okay. And that's probably the best place to get the Street Adopters Handbook. Okay. That's probably a good starting point if you want more material about it. And I'd love to talk with you about your experiences. So that's that talks about 200 cities that started Adopt a Street in the 2009 to 2011 timeframe.
Okay.
And then the Chinese version of it. We have some a video teaching that we did last summer with Barbara Chan in Hong Kong. So that's now going out in Cantonese as well as Mandarin subtitles. So you can learn about Adopt a Street through Barbara through the book and through her videos as well. Proclaiming the Kingdom is a book that's a fairly specialized title, and what we'll talk about in the next session or two is the difference between a city that's in bondage and a transformed city. Mm-hmm. I don't want to say a lot about that now, but the Lord took me to Newark and showed me three roots of bondage in the city of Newark. Number one was covetousness, people desiring other people's possessions. And that's related to idolatry, of course. Secondly, was a root of complacency, which is people seeing things that are wrong but not doing anything about them. And then the third root that we saw in Newark was bitterness. Mm-hmm. And that boils up in anger and resentment. That's part of the movement we see now. That's why we're responding to Adopt a Cop, is we see this root of bitterness that's in our cities. And when I shared this diagram, which I'll go to in more detail in a subsequent session, I shared it with Ed, and he said, "You know, we found the same three roots in Resistencia." Mm-hmm. We had to pray about covetousness, complacency, and bitterness with the pastors before we saw the breakthrough in Plan Resistencia. So I wouldn't submit that these three roots are the same in all cities in the world, but there's certainly a lot of cities in America, at least, and probably in other countries, where we have these same three roots. And that's where the intercessors really can shine, because the intercessors can pray for the roots, not just the fruit of those strongholds.
That's excellent. Good. I'm just putting for everybody here in the chat box those titles, Street Adopters Handbook, as well as Proclaiming the Kingdom. That one's also available on Amazon. Is that right, Lloyd? Or?
Yes, it is.
Okay, great. And then we've been mentioning here well, on DVDs. Oh, yep.
There we go.
Yes. It just stalled out for a second there. Those books are available on Amazon.com, and the DVD documentary stories are available at the transformourworld.org website as well. So those are great tools, like Lloyd was mentioning, and Becky as well, to kind of spur people on with the vision, helping people see what's possible. And there's, you know, a lot of things that you're going to be sharing in the course here, Lloyd, are covered there. So
let me just talk about my new book for a minute, as long as you're asking about the books. This is called Newark, City of Destiny. And in the year 1666, Newark was settled by Puritans from Connecticut who came to escape persecution. And they declared that the city would be, as nearly as possible, a kingdom of God on earth. That was a quote. And so when I was asked to write a book about the spiritual history of Newark, I went to Jesus' sermon on Luke chapter 4. And I'd like to share this with you as we meditate on some of these ideas. I hadn't planned on covering this in the course, but I think you'll enjoy it. It says, Luke 4, 18 and 19, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." So here's the idea. If that was Jesus' ministry, he has five aspects of his ministry that he defines here. It's good news to the poor. It's freedom for the prisoners. It's recovery of sight for the blind. It's release for the oppressed. And it's proclaiming the year of the Lord's favor, or the year of Jubilee. So in my book, I take each of those as a separate section of the book, and I talk about three people who saw a glimpse of God's kingdom advancing in Newark over time. And what these stories do is they cause you to see history in a new light. For example, we have a story about a shoemaker who came up with a better way to make shoes. And he discovered that if he had one person making the tops of the shoes and one person making the soles of the shoes and a third person putting them together, that he could make a lot more shoes in a day than he could by himself or by the three working independently. Yeah. It's a principle of division of labor, if you will. And as it proceeded, the man actually went to Georgia, and he sold 200 pairs of sealskin shoes, and the whole town heard that this guy was producing shoes faster than anyone else they'd ever heard of, and he was a Christian businessman. So in a day, he would train young apprentices how to make shoes with his new methods, and at night, up in the second story of his building, he would teach them the gospel, and as well as reading, writing, and arithmetic. And over the next 30 years, he trained a whole generation of Newarkers to become Christian businessmen with their own shoemaking businesses. So that's just one example of taking the gospel to the marketplace through shoemaking.
Wow, that's awesome. Awesome. Lloyd, before we wrap things up here with a closing prayer, which we'll ask you to do in a moment, got a question here that came through on my phone text message. Could you please give specific examples of what the adoption looked like using pre-evangelism? How often were streets prayed for? Did people walk them? What did it look like as people were walking the streets, if that's what they were doing?
Okay. And there's another question from Nancy as well. So we'll address the question you just raised. So we encourage people to do at least monthly prayer walks in their adopted neighborhood. And as you know, some people are put more energy into this than other people do. There's probably four or five neighborhoods where we did systematic prayer walking for several years. And some of those neighborhoods are still being prayer walked. Others, the person who was the captain moved on, and we need to find a replacement. So it's very important that the person who's the leader over your neighborhood is replaced and prayed for. So we did weekly prayer walks. Now, for the last 8 years, we've been doing quarterly meetings. And at the quarterly meetings, we have testimonies and success stories, and we also have problems that came up and issues that need prayer from other neighborhoods as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And as people, just to follow up on that, as people are actually, you know, physically out there walking the streets, you know, what does that look like? Everybody's kind of got their own personality, I guess, but you know, how have you seen that manifest with people actually prayer walking the street?
Well, we have one neighborhood in the West Ward where we went out with one of our African-American pastors, Dr. Harris, and she asked us to go down a certain street. So we went down there and we had a bunch of scarves with us that said WWJD, what would Jesus do? Mm-hmm. And they were beautiful. They were in purple, as I recall. And we went walking up and down the streets. We saw kids sitting on the steps of their house. And we just asked them, would you like a prayer shawl or a handkerchief, if you will? And they looked at each other, and they really wanted this. So they asked their mom if it was okay. The mom came out and asked us what we were doing. And we said, we're praying for your streets. Is there anything we can pray for you? And there was a lightness that occurred in that house when we went by and prayed for them. Another prayer meeting I was on, I was walking with some friends in a pretty tough neighborhood. There's a lot of drug traffic in that neighborhood. And as we were walking, there were four of us, I think, walking side by side. I just got a sense from the Holy Spirit to pray for foreclosure. Hmm. And you look up and down the street, there were a lot of houses that were being foreclosed because it was after the financial crunch in 2008. A lot of people couldn't make their payments. And so about 10 seconds after I got this inspiration, a man walks right in front of me, crosses our street, goes to the door of his house, and one of the people in our group says, sir, is there anything we can pray for you for? And he said, yes, my house is about to be foreclosed. So the Lord was using that particular moment to give us a word of knowledge about that not only this man's need, but also others on that street that needed prayer for finances.
Yeah, excellent. That's excellent. Good. Do you want to tackle the last question there from Nancy, and then we'll bring things to a close here?
So were these insights discerned in prayer from the Holy Spirit? And very much so, that if you read the book, Street Adopter's Handbook, Joanne asked the Lord one day, why should we pray for streets? And the word that she got in journaling, she asks the Lord for questions, and then she writes down what she hears on a paper. And the answer that she got and wrote down was, as you pray for the streets and businesses and homes, that the spirit of slavery will be replaced by the spirit of sonship. Mm-hmm. And that bondage will be replaced by adoption. And so we've kind of taken that all along. This was, as you recall, that was just about the time that Bishop Vaughn McLaughlin gave us the messages about the spirit of adoption. Mm-hmm. And so we were getting the very same message that Bishop Vaughn was about the spirit of adoption and how it applied to street adoption.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
And then the insights that we got about covetousness, complacency, and bitterness, yeah, those were also insights from the Holy Spirit. And what we'll talk about, and maybe this will be a good closing thought for us tonight, is that when you put together covetousness and bitterness, what you get is murder. That's in the extreme case. But the spirit of murder depends on two roots. It depends on a root of bitterness, and it depends on a root of covetousness. And if you want to reduce murder in your city, yeah, you can put up spotlights, and you can put up walls, and you can send more squad cars out. But unless you address the bitterness on the one hand and the covetousness on the other hand, the roots of that murder are still there in your city.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's where by partnering intercessors along with law enforcement officials like Becky, that the law enforcement people are going to lock up the people who need to be apprehended. Mm-hmm. But the intercessors need to go in advance and deal with those root issues that are causing the problems that we face in our cities today.
Excellent. I think that's a perfect place to kind of park it here for the night. So as we close the session tonight, Lloyd, would you pray for us?
Yeah. So Father God, we pray for everyone who's on this call today, as well as everyone that will listen to the recording. And we ask, Lord, that you would send insights and words of knowledge, that you would send ideas to everyone who listens and prays about this, because you care about the streets, Lord, more than we do. You care about the people who live, work, and worship on our streets. And we just thank you for this time today that we've had to share the awesome things that you are doing, starting in Resistencia, Argentina, going to Newark, New Jersey, going to 400 other cities around the U.S. and to 1,000 cities around the world, Lord, because you have promised that you're going to visit these places that we have raised up in prayer. So we ask all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Just a last reminder to everybody that we'll be back for week two, not next Tuesday, but the following Tuesday, March the 15th, for session two. So thank you so much, Lloyd. Thank you for joining us, Becky, as well. And for those of you on the live session, thank you for being with us. And we will see you all again in 2 weeks. So God bless you.
Please send your comments and emails to us if you have other questions as well.
Yes, excellent. All right. God bless you all.